talking about. Just write down this. Basically, there is a motivation for analog modulation. Initially, whatever you studied in your fourth semester was analog modulation. What was this analog modulation that we are talking about? This is to develop techniques for shifting the analog message signal from low to high frequency range. If it is a low frequency, the energy content is less and it cannot be transmitted for longer distances. So the energy content has to be raised so that it can be conveniently transmitted over high frequency communication channels. Isn't it? Over long distance communication channels. This resulted in what is known as AM, FM and PM techniques. What is AM? AM is amplitude modulation. And FM is frequency modulation. Then what we have is PM. PM is the phase modulation technique. So after that, after these AM, FM and PM, we have what is known as the pulse modulation techniques. So in these pulse modulation techniques that we are talking about, we have the message signal is done. So this is what we are talking about. In this are, you know that they are amplitude modulation, frequency modulation and digital modulation. So here we moved on to what is known as the pulse modulation, which represents the message signal. This is in discrete instances of time. So once it comes to pulse, it is discrete in nature. So this is taking at a given instant of time. However, the resulting message will still be in the low frequency range. So from this AM, FM, we move to what is known as pulse. And this is definitely digital, no doubt about it, but we still consider them as not completely digital because they are transmitted in very low frequency range. Therefore, there is a need for digitizing the message. When you want to digitize the message, this is nothing but what is the meaning? The moment you say digitizing of the message, that means the information is converted into zeros and ones. The moment it is converted into zeros and ones, then using a suitable pulse modulation technique, we can convert analog message into a digital form. Alternately, the message may be directly generated in digital form as you have in your computer system. What you are having is a completely digital format. So this is a digital form. So there is a need for long distance communication. What we need is a digitization of the signals. So therefore, there is a requirement in the digital communication field. What is the requirement? The requirement is to transfer the digital message from one place to the other. To transfer it from one place to the other. When you are transferring, what is happening? There are broadly two approaches. In the digital communication field, you have what is known as, there are two types, please make a note. They are known as baseband digital transmission and passband transmission. So there is definitely a need to convert into a digital information or digital messages. So what is it that you are doing? You have two types here when we discuss, and these are the two types that we are talking about. In these two types, one is called the baseband digital transmission, the other one is called passband transmission. Now, baseband digital transmission involves transmission of digital messages in the low frequency range itself. Okay, baseband. See, when people are singing, we say they are singing with the bass voice, and some people have the capability to sing or to modulate their voice to the situation and the occasion. So some things, sometimes these singers have the capability to, you know, change their voice. Some sing like a child, some sing like an aged person, or some will sing with a lot of enthusiasm. Thereby the mood swings, according to the swings of the mood swinging, you are changing, you are acclimatizing, or you are modulating your voice according to that. This is nothing but a technical language, voice modulation. So some people sing in their normal voice, which you call that as a bass voice. Some people will, you know, they will be able to adjust their pitch, modulation, voice, quality and so on. So that is known as bass voice. What is the difference? Originally, if you are singing in your own set, then it is called as, you know, traversing with the same frequency as is required. So, but that you cannot do it for long distance communication. Therefore, what is needed here is to transmit this by raising the frequency to higher frequency. That higher frequency range is referred to as the pass band. So let us see what this is, what we are talking about. So that actually, when people talk also, some people, when you hear any news channels that people are giving news readers, especially the star type of news channels, there are some who will be reading the news as though you are able to visualize the scene what they are describing. That means they are able to voice modulate and attain, and their modulation is so flexible that they are able to adapt to what they are talking about, what they are describing. Whereas some people, whether it is a happy occasion or a tragedy, whatever it is, they will be just reading in the same tone as it is otherwise. So these are all the different ways. I'm just giving you an example. So likewise, you have two types. Now, since original data or the message is in the baseband range, what is needed here is, first, this is the first step in digital communication. In the digital communication, the first step is to convert, first modulate it to the high frequency range and then transmit it. So you cannot just transmit it as it is, because it won't convey and it won't be carried longer. So first set of modulation is to change it into high frequency and then allow the transmission to take place. So what is it that you are doing? You are shifting it from the pass band to, you are transferring it into pass band from the baseband. And this is termed as a digital modulation technique. This is a very important technique referred to as a digital modulation technique. Oh. So far so good as far as the digital modulation is concerned. Then, these digital modulation techniques are based on the conventional analog modulation techniques only. We are not moving away from the analog communication. It is dependent on this only. But here, the message will have only two levels. If it is analog means you represent it by a sine wave as a function of time. It is a voltage as a function of time, sine or cosine. And it is a continuously varying interval. It is an infinite interval. So the message consists of a continuous variation. Whereas in the case of digital modulation, the technique is that it will have only two levels of information, which is represented by your square wave. So it is 0, 1, 0, 1. So 0 means absence of the signal, and 1 refers to presence of the signal. Only two things are there. So therefore, what is required is to transform it into higher frequency digitized signals. So thereby what we have is a digital modulation, which is further divided into three types known as amplitude shift keying, frequency shift keying and phase shift keying. What does it mean? Keying means sending in the information. So it deals with, it is actually, there is a shift in three parameters. So what actually you can do is, you can represent any signal, the instantaneous values, let us say, by Vm sin omega m t plus phi. Therefore, in this case, this is the instantaneous value. This is the amplitude. Vm, I am writing it with a capital letter, so it refers to the amplitude. This refers to frequency. This refers to swings. This refers to phase. This phase. So if you change amplitude, you call it as amplitude modulation. This is a signal. So what we have is a carrier. Carrier is given by sin omega ct plus phi. This is the instantaneous value of the carrier. So once again, this is your amplitude. This is frequency. So if you change, as you know, in the case of analog also, if you change amplitude, you get amplitude modulation. If you change the frequency of the carrier with respect to this, we get frequency modulation. And if you change phase, what we get is phase modulation. Here, you are shifting it. If it deals with shifting the amplitude of the carrier signal between two distinct values, then because you are shifting by keying in the information, this is referred to as amplitude shift keying. Similarly, what we have is frequency shift keying. It deals with shifting the frequency of the carrier signal between two distinct values. Next, it deals with shifting the phase of the carrier signal between two values. So therefore, we have three types of modulation: amplitude shift keying, frequency shift keying, and phase shift keying. Depending on the application, we will be using that particular type of modulation technique. Have you made a note, girls? Just prompt me, are you able to make a note of this? Did you write down? So this is about different types of modulation. So what we discussed is, what is a digital modulation, what is digitization, what are the two different types of modulation, and after this, how do you change it so that you get different modulation techniques. Then let's go on to the next one, that is let's talk about one by one. That is, I'm just changing the size of this. Let's discuss more about amplitude shift gain. So in short, it is referred to as ASK. ASK is a digital modulation technique which is defined as a process of shifting the amplitude. What is important is shifting the amplitude of the carrier signal between two levels. So, what we are talking about is carrier signal. Carrier wave is shifted between two levels. Depending on whether 1 or 0 is to be transmitted. This is a digital communication. So, the entire information has to be transferred only with respect to 1 or 0. So, depending on whether the information is the high state or a zero state, accordingly your carrier wave gets registered. So let the message be the binary sequence of ones and zeros, and it can be represented as a function of time like this. This is your instantaneous value of the modulating signal, which is equal to Vm. This is amplitude. This is equal to Vm when the symbol is 1. That means when the transmission signal is 1, when there is a signal present, we represent it as equal to Vm, and that is 1. And it is 0 when the symbol is 0. So these are the two levels in which your carrier wave is switching. So let the carrier wave, this is a modulating signal, I'm sorry, this is modulating signal or the signal carrying information. This is the signal carrying data, or also known as information. Next, the carrier, let it be defined by Vc, again as a function of time t, is equal to Vc cos omega ct. Once again, this capital A is amplitude. The notation is small and lowercase refer to instantaneous values, uppercase refers to the maximum value, maximum displacement, which is nothing but amplitude. So now, this is this A Vc that has to change. It is this Vc that has to change with respect to changes in the carrier wave. So now, how do you do this? The corresponding ASK signal is given by ASK's amplitude shifting key is given by a product of Vm into Vc. So a product of what is amplitude of modulating signal? It is Am Vm into multiplied with Vc cos omega ct. It is a product of Vm and Vc when the symbol is 1 and it is 0 when the symbol is 0. So you are able to see that the shift of the carrier between the two signal levels. One is 0 always, the other one is either Vm cos omega t into Vc cos omega ct if you are combining, otherwise it is only Vc cos omega ct. So now, ASK is when the carrier signal's instantaneous amplitude is varied in proportion to the message signal, we have what is known as a modulated carrier chip. So, when the carrier signal's instantaneous amplitude is varied in proportion to message signal. So, we have Vm, the instantaneous value of Vm, modulating signal, Vc, the instantaneous value of the carrier. So, as information is also, one more thing is, as the information can also be written as A. as the information is also an on-off signal, the output is also known as an off signal, where the carrier is present, when the information is gone, and carrier is absent when the information is given. Please remember this. It is, and therefore this scheme is also referred to as OOK. In some textbooks, we will read this as OOK. OOK refers to what? On-off key. Keying is nothing but inputting the information. Input the information is referred to as key. Okay. So now, what is it that we are trying to do is, output is an on-off signal where the carrier is present when the information is 1. The carrier is absent when the information is 0. Thus, this modulation scheme is referred to as on-off keying information. So this is a figure. This is the figure that you can see. So this is a carrier, continuous waveform of high frequency. This is a modulating signal or information or message signal. Now what is it that you are doing? This is zero. This part, as you can see, is zero. Because it is zero, signal carrier wave is absent. Here again it is. So you are seeing only when there is presence of signal. Only at these points, which is equal to 1, you are able to see the value. So this is 1, this is 1, this is 1. So because there is presence of signal, carrier is present. When there is no carrier being present, then it is a zero signal. This is how we represent an amplitude modulated signal. Okay? So where do you use this? You will be using this. It is used in infrared remote controls. You must be all using your control signals, using your TV remote controls. This is also used in fiber optical transmitters and receivers. This is fiber optical communication is used in this, your 4G spectrum, 5G spectrum, the long distance cables. Whenever you want to use, and whenever you want to use for long distance communication, long distance communication, we use what is known as fiber optics. Fiber optical cables. Earlier, whenever this telephone department or any other person want to lay down the cables, they used to dig underground, and such huge spools of bundles used to be laid. They always follow the ropes. Now there is no need. It's from pole to pole. And the cable is, when we come to optics lab anytime, we just see we have a fiber optical cable, and we have one lab also in our location. The transmission and communication between two computers, we will show you using fiber optical communication. It's a lossless communication. You can bundle the wires, you can do spooling, anything you can do, the information will not be lost. And it is a very compact, it won't be such big bundles. You must be seeing this in your house also. When your internet provider is giving you a spool of wires, that is nothing but a fiber optical communication. This is considered to be lossless communication also. So this is where you will be using what is known as this type of communication. So this is the application. Then we will talk about what is known as, next one is frequency communication. This is the skin. So when the information bit is 1, carrier bit, there are two signals which are being transmitted in the case of frequency shift. So what are the two frequencies? Omega C1 and omega C2, or some books they write it as 0 and 1. So when the information bit is 1, carrier with omega C1 is transmitted, that is cos omega C1. And when the information bit is 0, then omega C0 will be transmitted, that is cos. See, some books write it as two frequency components. I will give you the mathematical details slowly. Just understand the qualitative part. You have two frequencies. Some books write it as omega C1 and cos omega C2. Or some books write it as 0 and 1. So what is it happening here? Just see here. This is a carrier signal. This is the modulating signal. So what is it that you are getting here? You have two components of frequencies. When it is maximum, look at only the modulating signal. This is 1, this is 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and 0. The points where it is maximum, their frequency is less. When it is minimum, the frequency here is more. Or when the frequency is more, time period is less. It's coming closer. You can see compressions and rarefactions. Where is it being compressed? Compressed most when it is 0, and it is rarefactory, that means it is spread out at the point where it is 1. 1, it is maximum deviation, 0, it is minimum deviation. So this is where you will be using what is known as So this is what you are taking, this is a frequency shift change. Next you have a PSK or phase shift. Here, the instantaneous phase of the carrier is shifted from this modulation. In amplitude, amplitude is shifted. In frequency, it is shifted between two frequency components, omega C1 and omega C2. And in the case of phase modulation, then it is, if the signal is 1, carrier in phase is transmitted. If signal is 0, carrier without phase is transmitted. So what is it that you have to look here is, when signal is present, carrier in phase. When the signal is absent, that means it is 0, this is 1, then carrier wave will be out of phase. If the phase shift is done in four different quadrants, then second wave. So that means, see, if you have one phase, when it is 1. When it is 0, it is out of phase. That means, if you have one bit only, you are getting 2. If you have 2 bits, you will get 4 quadrants. If you have 3 bits, you will get 8 different possibilities. So, what is it that you are doing? It is expressed always by 2 power n. If you have n is equal to 1, you have only 2. Clockwise or counterclockwise. If n is equal to 2, then you have how many? 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Each of them corresponds to 190 degrees. So when carrier is shifted by 90, it is 0, 0. If it is shifted by 180, it is 0, 1. If it is 270, it is 0, 1, this is, okay, 360. Actually, these are all coded. What is it that we are talking about? Depending on this angle what I am talking about, this 90, 180, 270 and 360 corresponds to four quadrants, isn't it? So each of them is shifted by a phase by 90 degrees. So what is it that we are talking about? If it is 1, it will move in the clockwise direction. If it is 0, it will move in the anti-clockwise direction. So it is basically used in all our mobile communications, satellite communications, and ADSL both. I do not know how many of you know about this ADSL. Before this internet revolution has come, you all must have heard something called as a broadband. Have you heard? BSNL used to give a broadband connection. So what you do is, it will be something like a modem with green flashing lights. Actually fluorescent lights. They'll be blinking, and it used to be that the telephone line, if you remember, was shaped. Your telephone line was shaped between computer and your system and telephone. So when somebody is using the system for the internet, telephone was disabled, isn't it? So such applications are not required now. We are using internet without telephone, without these lines of communication. Therefore, that ADSL board is digital signal board is not required. Okay. So such applications you will be using amplitude shifting. So these are the applications. So now let us see what is it that we are talking about. We are talking so far, I have just discussed only the graphical part. I didn't go into the mathematical details. So we learned about amplitude shift keying, frequency shift keying, and phase shift keying. So these are all the different techniques which are used for digital communication. Now, what is the advantage of this digital communication? Let us see what is the advantage. I don't know whether you are able to see this or see this the form. So for simplicity, we shall assume that information is being transmitted by a sequence of binary pulses. So during the course of propagation, where are you sending this information? You are sending them on the channel. Channel is nothing but a medium for propagation. Channel is nothing but a medium. Space can be one medium. Okay, your telephone lines, your cable lines, all these twisted cables, coaxial cables, fiber optical cables, all these cables are also a medium which is used for propagation. So during the course of propagation on the channel, a transmitted pulse becomes gradually disturbed due to the non-ideal transmission characteristics of the channel. What do you understand by this? When it is being transmitted, the signal is getting disturbed. Why is it getting disturbed? Due to the non-ideal transmission characteristics of the channel. That means it is not ideal. That means as information is coming to the channel, it should immediately transmit. But this does not happen. Therefore, there is a non-ideal behavior. Diode also, we have non-ideal characteristics, ideal characteristics. Because of various external parameters, the temperature, the presence of noise, and maybe somewhere some lightning. Because if you don't use fiber optical communication, if you use cables, there is a possibility of any disturbance, lightning, thunders, and so on. So all these are non-ideal characteristics. So they will interfere with the transmission of the information. So that is when you are sending the analog information. So that's one reason why there is a shift of digital communication, which is a desirable thing. Also, the second thing is various unwanted signals, that is usually termed as interference and noise. It will cause further deterioration of the information bearing parts. The unwanted signals can come from, it can be from the system. The unwanted signals can come from the system. It can be electrical disturbances. Or sometimes the dust is gathered on these devices. It becomes yet another medium for propagation. So what happens is, whenever there is a dust on the systems, it will be working more. There is a pressure on the system. So when there is a dust, actually what happens, it heats up the system. You must have observed it. Heats up the devices. When it is heating, heating is a loss. So that means there is a loss of energy. When there is a loss of energy, that means whatever information is reaching the device, you are not able to get the full utilization of the capacity of the channel. Whenever you are getting heated, when the system is getting heated, that means that there is some loss of information. So, when a low frequency signals are sent, the interference usually happens for low frequency signals. As you go up, as you go to higher ranges of stratosphere, atmosphere, there are different layers of the atmosphere. As you go higher up, the normal disturbances will not be taking place. So you must have observed the local distribution channels, especially TV channels. Local cable channels are very weak, and very normally you will tend to get a disturbance and the signal goes off. You will get a white screen. But if the same transmission is done with your satellite communication, if you are able to see using star channels, Sony, DTH, all these channels directly relayed from satellites. Therefore, the interference is minimal there. I cannot say it is completely reduced, but it can be minimized in satellite communication. So therefore, however, in the digital, one of the disadvantages that we can have is that it is only two types of signals, either on or off are being transmitted. So it is possible for us to identify with very high probability. If you have two, so what is the probability? On or off. So probability is 1 by 2, isn't it? So that is 50%. 50% off, 50% on. So high probability you can have. And then a given transmitted pulse at some appropriate intermediate point on the channel. And so that's one. So what it means is, if you find fault in the course of transmission at any appropriate point on the channel, then we can give, there are error detection mechanisms, error correction mechanisms, error detection and error correction. So when you feel that a particular code that is being transmitted is not appropriate or is not correct, we can ask, regenerate a clean pulse. Thereby, the system, the transmitter can revert back and ask the transmitter to send it again. So that we can eliminate the effect of distortion and noise till the point of regeneration. That means a signal is transmitted, it has reached one particular point, there you find fault. That means, they suppose you have to send 4 1-bits. If you have to send 4 bits of information all once, suppose you are sent this at the receiver. So which bit is fault? This bit is fault. So once it reaches, it will be sent back. It will be waiting until a 1-bit comes. Then only it will proceed to the fourth. So this is known as bit course correction. It is all possible in case of digital transmission of signals. So very often, when you feel your TV transmission is not correct, and if you are not able to see the signal being properly transmitted, you always ring up to them, keep in touch with them. They will actually make corrections at their dish level, at their antenna level, and do the corrections. Provided the cable operator is smart enough. Otherwise, they have the same faulty signal being transmitted for unlimited period of time. So these are the few advantages of digital communication. Such an operation therefore is not possible if the transmitted signal was analog, because there is nothing like a reference waveform that can be generated. So what is this reference waveform that we are talking about? Let's say suppose you are expected to send a message. Which is abbreviated, let us say, as 8 bits. Suppose this is information which is coded and is being transmitted. So at the receiver also, you are expected to receive this information. So there is a reference. You know what is expected. And when a transmitter is sending, you will compare this with this reference. And if you, how do you know which is correct and which is not correct? Only when you compare the received signal with that of the standard or reference, you can say what you got is correct or not. So there is some kind of a feedback mechanism whereby you are able to check. That is known as your reference or wave. So if it is not matching, as you have seen in this case, you are sending it back. So the transmitted signal, this is not possible if it is analog signal. If it is analog, continuously the signal is changing all the points. And there is no way to correct it in between. Because the infinite interval of time in which the signal is undergoing multiple changes, multiple transmissions, multiple interferences, and hence it becomes difficult to spot the errors. And since you are not able to spot the error, you can't even correct it. And therefore, there is a need, and therefore, there is a requirement for digitizing the information, and hence we call this as a digital communication. So, storing the message in digital form and forwarding or redirecting them at a later point in time is quite simple. Why are we doing all the information? You are sending the information, you are saving them as electronic mails, you are saving them in your drives, in your flash drives, and then all those things. Why are you doing it? Because storing the messages in digital form and forwarding them at a later point becomes you are able to see this. I think you are able to see the advantage of this. Imagine the same thing if it has to be done. Your notes, if you are sharing the handwritten notes, I am not saying it is not correct, but after a few days, there is a possibility of, you know, the information being corrupted. Therefore, there is a need. And exchange of information also. Now we are seeing how you are able to see. In one class, I showed you in the lab how to transmit the communication between your systems over Wi-Fi, over Bluetooth devices, okay, and also over your router. There are LAN connected, so you are able to transfer, view the information on all the different systems. And hence, managing the information exchange is easier if it is in the digital form. Next, coding the message sequence to take care of the channel noise. Encryption is also easily done. So, what is this coded information that we are talking or encoding? Encoding is also known as crypting, cryptography, most of the word. Cryptographic information. Usually used in intelligence operations, defense operations. when you don't want enemies to know what information you are sharing, generally it is done with an encoder or cryptography. So crypting is also becoming easy when you are having digital information. So I think in the last semester I have given you an assignment where if you want to send any message, you can encode the message and see whether the receiver is receiving the message in its correct state or not. So this is possible even you can fix if it is in the analog. Mixing the signals is easy. All signals look alike after conversion to digital form, independent of the source or language, hence they can easily be multiplexed and demultiplexed. Zeros and ones remain the same. So whether you have 8 bits, 16 bits, 32 bits, it's only manipulation of data of zeros and ones. Okay? So if it is language also can be coded. You have language translators, language encoders, so that also is being encrypted. All this becomes easy. Imagine you have in India, you have different languages, different accents, different vocabulary and different grammar. So what is the past tense may not be the same as the future tense, that verbs and all are different in different languages. Imagine if it has to be done with an analog. So what information has to go as a future tense if it goes as past tense, you are giving a wrong message. So instead, if the message is nowadays, that is your Google Assistant, your Alexa, all these are doing what? How do you think? Do you think that there is a person sitting there? It's nothing but an AI algorithms that developed, artificial intelligence algorithms, algols we call it. All these are developed and your voice, whatever you are talking, is converted into a text message which is digitized. This is your digital communication. You have your Amazon services and Amazon Web Services is excellent in doing this. In digital marketing and many other applications. All these are algorithms which are developed on nothing but digital communication. Examples of digital communication. Last semester you done a couple of projects on how this alligator, Uber and LR, all these people are able to track, and when you ring up, how it is the information that is being sent to a driver in your area, your GPS, all this is, you know, it's because of its project. So these are all the different ways in which we are able to enjoy the benefits of communication. Okay? So now, go back to this. So now, let me show you some more examples. I am following. Which book am I following? I'm following the book by name George Kennedy, Digital Communication Electronics. I'll just show the book to you. So this is the book I am following, Digital Electronic Communication Systems by George, and this is also stored in your, shared in your Google Classroom. So this is the, so a better diagram, amplitude shift gain. So 1 0 1 0 1 1 0 0 1 0, 1 it is high, 0 it is absence of the signal, this is amplitude shift gain. 1 presence of the signal, 0 absence of the signal. And these two are the points where you are able to see that these are the points where the signal is present. You are getting this 0, 0, 1, 1. So this is how you are able to see the time domain. This is known as, because you are plotting it across time, this is referred to as time domain frequency. So what is a block diagram? You are multiplying, you are giving an input, and multiplier is multiplying Vm and Vc. What you are getting is an output, which is amplitude shift k. Then you have the, I'll just show the figures first and then this is about this. Another example, the same way. Next is frequency shift gain. So just another example I'm showing you. Here you have, this is what modulating signal, isn't it? Which is better? Are you able to see it properly? Actually, increase the font. This is better. So this is your carrier wave. Carrier wave is having two frequency components, one higher frequency, one lesser frequency. So that is FC plus FL, this is FC minus FL. So what is it that you are doing? You are, now this becomes your center. This is your left frequency, this is your right frequency. At this point again, you have another wave rectangular pulse. Here you have another rectangular pulse. So this is actually, what are you doing? This carrier signal is combined with the modulating signal. Then you have a pattern like this coming, one onto the left, one onto the right. Okay, so what actually happens is, so this is how we are getting. So this is the frequency shift gain. This is what your amplitude signal is coming. Now, if you want to convert it into S1 signal, one signal here, one signal here. See, the width of the signal is proportional to the frequency here. Here it is on for 2 periods, isn't it? So this is the frequency component, this is your time period. Here it is only for 1, so it is less. So another frequency is coming like this, and these two are combined. When you combine, this is what you get. When it is maximum, this is like this. When it is minimum, it is compression. This is the original sound. So all this is your frequency signal carrier wave. Then I will discuss the mathematical part. I just want to show you the diagrams to. So this is the original ASK, one frequency here, one frequency here for FSK. So combined is what you get, and this is one phase, this is another phase. So combined, this is the pattern that you are getting. So it's almost analog signal is being replicated though you digitize it. So this is what you are getting, and these are all the different techniques in which you will be getting this kind of things. So I think today, let me stop here at this point. So in the next class, we will do a little bit of mathematical treatment of this. So right now, I'm